Come on, give it up, guys, for Mr. Karan Johar.
Hi, and good afternoon. I think I've gone up against protocol and I'm talking to you. I wasn't meant to. It was meant to be Anupama Chopra. No one told us that there was a traffic situation in the city. Hello. And it took me an hour to get in here from Mayfair, so my apologies. I'm running a little late, but the member of media is running even later than I am. So she's apparently walking here now. That might take a while. It's good. I'm really happy I've made a critic walk. Because trust me, they do a lot sometimes to torture our existence, especially when they have opinions and we have to endure them. Anu's a dear friend. I'm just pulling her leg, really. And when she comes, I'll say the same. She's somebody I've known very affectionately for very many years. I have to say, every time I'm in a room that is full of so much energy, it just makes everything I do seems so worth it. I've spoken at various academic institutions and Ivy League colleges and schools over the past decade. Ironical, because I never got into any of them when I tried. I didn't try hard enough, actually, because at a very young age, I was told that if you want to make Hindi movies, you don't need to be qualified, which doesn't speak very highly of the fraternity I come from. But it does reflect some of the harsh realities of our academic existence. So yes, I've been to Harvard, and I've been to Wharton, and I've been to NYU, and I've spoken and engaged with so many young and interesting and alive minds such as yours. And I have to say, I had the privilege and honor to film at LSE, just one entrance shot and a top shot that got cut and a side shot that got cut. And we weren't allowed to use LSE because there was a contractual obligation. We were not meant to. We were told not to. Ranbir, the character that no one loved in the movie, was meant to be from doing his MBA at LSE, and that ended quite sadly for him, because he didn't land up doing his MBA. He started singing songs, and he wasn't singing to anyone who loved him back. So it was quite tragic. But I have to say that thank you very much for hosting me. Thank you, and congratulations. Congratulations for everything that you guys are doing and for this wonderful platform that I've been invited to. Normally, the reverse happens. We do a Q&A and then we open the questions up to the house. But because we don't have anyone to ask me any questions, because she's walking, and last spotted, she was where the pigeons lie, apparently, at Trafalgar Square. I'm imagining 5 foot nothing Anupama Chopra trying to huddle away to LSE. It's sounding a bit strange, but I hope she makes it. Every time a door opens, I think it's her. No, but this, no, he's tall, it can't be her. All right, so I'm going to open this up. You guys have apparently been waiting a little bit, so apologies again for my delay, but you know, I didn't realize there was a traffic situation. I didn't realize that our problems in Mumbai persist here as well. Shoot, ask me anything you want. I have no problem. My life is now a closed book, so everything's out there anyway. There's very little left to anyone's imagination, and the things I've kept to myself, I plan to keep to myself. So yeah, hi, anyone has any questions for me? Okay, I'm going to pretend like I'm moderating this session. Yes, hello, hi. Do you need a mic or are you audible enough? All right.
I just wanted to ask you, when are you doing another roast with AIB?
I have absolutely no problem doing the roast. It's just that I would love to be in the audience now and not on stage. I think we are probably the only guys who will get away with it, and we did. And it happened. It was one of its kind, and it's not going to happen again because I can't deal with those FIRs anymore. I mean, you know, everyone and their grandfathers had a problem with what we said on that stage, and a lot of it was I'm not very proud of. But we got a bit carried away, and we all knew what we were saying, and I didn't realize that everyone was saying even more wilder and like out there stuff. Though I have to say that we'd probably go down in history, if not anywhere else, for actually being the first gang that were roasted. I doubt it's going to happen for a really long time, because I think AIB will do everything else but do a roast again. Yeah, hi.
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 Why? Don't say that about yourself.
I've dreamt of this all my life. I'm little, you know.
I've been part of your dream.
That's my question also to you. That's okay. My question to you. You know how you say Bollywood sells dreams?
Right.
You had sold Raj, Rahul, all these perfect men to me. Then I came to the LSE. Great guys out there. But then I saw Ae Dil Hai Mushkil and I see all these movies and I'm like, yaar, sapne pure nahi hote.
Haan, bilkul pure nahi hote.
Well, Karan, why did you break all our hearts?
Well, I didn't break. I gave you dreams. Isn't that something to give? I mean, it's such a beautiful thing to give anyone. It's a dream. I mean, I didn't. I actually made you realize that what you don't get in the real world, at least you can get in your dreams.
In Karan Johar.
Listen, there's no such thing as a Raj and Rahul. They're quite stupid and spineless at times. In fact, I want to tell you, I mean, I can speak for Rahul because I didn't create Raj. But Rahul was a really full of double standard kind of guy. Like he said, ek hi baar jeete, ek hi baar marte, ek hi baar shaadi. He did everything twice, dude. I mean, you know, what was his problem? Like he was clearly into total double existence mode. So don't buy everything you see. Enjoy that it's Shah Rukh Khan with his arms open, looking great with that Adam's apple and perfect everything else. Messy hair, beki nigahein bikhre baal. But it doesn't really, really translate
into... Do you still believe in love or no?
No, of course you believe in love. You love.
Or personally, you love. Yourself.
Personally, I believe in love. I believe in many four-letter words. Okay. But it depends what your perspective of love is.
Sure.
If your idea of love is a Hallmark card, then I suggest you change it.
Thank you.
Because out there it's like, lust is a good word as well. Okay. Yes, darling, how are you? You know what happened to me the last time, right? You know, I came out of that alive. Look, I have to say that for me, I believe talent has no boundaries. And you know that I'm completely leftist in my approach to life. But unfortunately, I stand in a minority in my left wing of life. So there are modalities and there are legalities and there is a circumstance that surrounds us that restricts some of our exceptionally progressive thoughts. Sometimes I believe that I wish I wasn't accountable, but I'm a citizen of the country that makes me kind of do what I need to do and follow the diktat that the environment suggests. But having said that, I think some of the most exceptional talent comes from Pakistan. And I had the honor and pleasure to actually direct Fawad Khan and have seen his exceptional work. And I think it was immensely brave of him to do what he did in Kapoor and Sons. I think after six actors had said no to that part, I think it was tremendously courageous of him to say yes. And I wish that, you know, our cinema and cinema in general would be exposed to such enormous talent like Fawad Khan. Hi. In London. Thank you for liking Ae Dil Hai Mushkil. Yes, I am currently at work. I'm trying to write something that, I don't know, it's like I'm oscillating between two subjects. I also have a short film to write. We're making Bombay Talkies 2. All of us, Zoya, me, in fact, Zoya wrapped her film like before and I was very jealous because I haven't even thought of what I want to make next. Dibakar, Anurag, Zoya and me are coming out with the second season, so I have to write that first. The long film I'm still thinking about and I hope to find something really soon and be on sets by the end of this year. What is my favorite bar and restaurant? Well, I don't go to bars anymore. I just feel a little old for them now. Restaurant, there are a couple of them. My dog is named after a restaurant in London called Nobu. So maybe it should qualify as my favorite restaurant because I love my dog. Yes, darling.
And I are actually friends. We hated each other in college, but then we watched Kuch Kuch Hota and we became best friends. Crazy story.
Your best friend's a man or a woman?
A woman.
Okay.
And
okay.
We both, that's the reason we're friends today. But my question to you was, would Dharma Productions ever consider doing web series now?
Yeah, we're planning to, but I mean, I don't want to be like joining the party because everyone's in it. We're trying to kind of work some stuff out and something interesting. There's something that is like large and cinematic, but on that format. And we're thinking, one of our directors at Dharma Productions actually might be developing something really exciting, and that might be a big series. Right now, web series is like seems to be the order of the day and the fashionable thought in the world of entertainment in India, but I don't know how much of it is really translating into something that is solid. So we are looking at it, but yeah, probably we'll have a digital division soon at Dharma. Yes. Oh, top. Oh, yes. Yes, hi.
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 Can you say hi to
my mom? Do I look good from there?
Sorry?
Is it lonely at the top? I know it is.
So basically, I just wanted to ask you to say hi to my mom.
Hi. What's your mom's
Padma
name?
Manjunath.
Sorry?
Padma.
Sorry?
Padma.
Padma.
Yeah.
All right. So hi, Padma. How are you? Your daughter's gorgeous. I'm sure you're even better looking.
Well, I guess I'll see you in your next movie.
Sorry?
I'll see you in your next movie then.
You'll see me. Darling, if you've got to see me in a movie, you'll see Bombay Velvet. And that won't be something that anyone is proud of. Yes.
In the recent Coffee with Karan episode with Saif Ali Khan, he passed a few sexist and borderline homophobic comments. And so do you think that is pretty common in the industry by the people?
No personal questions, please.
No, I'm asking, is that common?
Is that personal? Sorry, okay.
No, I'm asking, is that common with the actors? I mean, is that ignorance?
I don't know. Firstly, I don't think what he meant was homophobic. I think he just kept, Saif has a sense of humor that you have to catch in sequence. He has this sitcom kind of timing even when he says things. So I think sometimes he's anything but homophobic. I mean, he's completely liberated, bohemian, headspace is completely out there as an individual and human being. I don't think he meant to be homophobic at all. If at all it came across, I think it was just him rambling along. And he was with Kangana, so I don't blame him. So I think you should excuse anything you heard on that show, because if anybody was saying more than required, it was her.
Okay.
Yeah. I think like Mr. Bachchan was irreplaceable. I think Shah Rukh, Amir and Salman and the longevity they've had as superstars, I think you can't erase from the history of Indian cinema. I think the kind of weightage, the audience that they had over the years, the equity they've built in the last 2.5 decades, I don't think the kids in this generation will probably enjoy that, because there are not that many people watching our movies in cinemas in those numbers. Just to give you statistics, there were more people that watched movies in the 80s, 90s than they do today. Double or triple the number. So unfortunately, the number of people won't be there to love them in that kind of enormity that Shah Rukh, Amir and Salman have enjoyed. So I don't think that there can be another Shah Rukh Khan or an Amir or Salman, and I think they're etched very strongly in their own zone. But if just raw talent is something that to consider, I think Ranbir Kapoor is an incredible talent. And I think that he's somebody who makes interesting choices. He may stumble on some wrong ones, and he might even maybe be unconventional at times, but you can't grab away the fact that I think he's the finest actor we have in this generation. Oh, wow, call her then. Where is she? Should I give her an introduction?
We can take one of
them. Yeah, yeah.
About La La Land.
Right.
Do you think it's, I mean, as a admirer of your films and others, I thought the adoration for La La Land was entirely illiterate in the idiom of music and dance.
Right.
What did you think? Did you think this was an audience that hadn't actually embraced the, the genre of how to do music and dance and drama in the way that yours and other films have done?
So can I be completely honest? I was crazily and madly in love with La La Land. And I loved it. And I thought if you remember, if you've seen Abhiman, it was actually Abhiman on acid, which is what I thought La La Land was. And I watched it, and I was just mesmerized with the way I think Damien Chazelle handled everything from the narrative to incorporating. Hello. I'm so sorry, Anu, but I've held court.
They've all just realized they don't need me at all.
No, I need you. But I'm answering a question before I... Okay, it's always fun to have a Chopra and a Johar in one room. So, going back to La La Land, and I know that there were so many... I was so surprised that there were people who had such polarized responses, which is something that is I'm used to hearing when on certain films, especially mine. But I, in fact, was so bored watching Moonlight that I was like in the minority, and I discussed this with Anu, and I was like, when that slip-up happened, I thought something happened to me. I was watching it live, and I was like, they can't give the award to Moonlight. I felt like somebody had to listen to my objection. So I mean, it's like, you know, it's really like it's all about your personal choice. I know what you say, that you think that Indian cinema has done song and dance efficiently and effectively over the so, but I thought the way Damien Chazelle just handled the emotional energy of the two characters, brought it together to that outstanding last act. I do believe Whiplash is a superior film. And again, his last act in Whiplash is fantastic. And if at all, I think he deserved much more than he got for Whiplash. But I think La La Land is special. So we've skipped the post. We've done that.
Okay, honestly, I am so, so sorry.
It's not your fault. I got stuck in copious amounts of traffic.
You know, there's some protest. Everything is shut. I'm never late. I'm far more professional than this. Apologies.
No, that's fine. Is there a hand mic there that I can... No, that's fine. These are... Oh, they catch. Okay. I feel I have to keep bending otherwise. Huh?
So we don't have to bend.
Which is fine, but anyway.
Okay. You couldn't resist.
I never can.
Okay. So, Karan, I first interviewed Karan just before Kabhi Khushi Kabhi Gham released.
Right.
Which was, 17, 18 years ago. And over the years, I've sort of course, watched his movies and followed his career and watched him kind of get bigger and bigger in terms of just sort of surround sound and amplification. And I think, so Karan, here's my personal hypothesis right now, that you've sort of evolved into a sort of entity that is more revealing, that's of course extremely contradictory, but it's sort of, it reveals more about people, what they interpret you as, than it says about you. So it's sort of like a Rorschach test, you know, right. That's who you are, a human Rorschach test, right. Because you are supposed to be, you know, you're of course, the talk show host of a show that's considered sort of frivolous and gossipy, but you are, as Atish Tasi wrote in the New York Times, the man who brought homosexuality into Indian homes by stealth. Your films are often dismissed for being, you know, bubblegum melodramas, but you're the man invited to Harvard and Davos and now LSE to talk about Indian culture. We think of you as friend of the superstars, but your book, An Unsuitable Boy, is sort of filled with loneliness and ache. So are you all of these things, none of these things, some of these things?
That's like a life, not a question. I don't know, actually, Anu. To answer that really seriously, I don't think I strategized or planned any of the above. People's perceptions come because some of them feel accountable to their sense of intelligence and intellectualism, including yourself. I think that, you know, you're a member of the media and you have a certain perspective on what you think cinema should be. And yet we have our guilty pleasures, and I think I've become people's guilty pleasure. And I have no problem with that because I love what I do. I love the movies I make, and even when I've made I think, progressive moves in cinema. I don't think I've ever got the right kind of acknowledgement or the right due, because there is a talk show that, like you said, is perceived to be frivolous, that tones down the serious filmmaker in me. But should I change that? Should I adopt a different kind of personality type to adhere to and conform to what people expect of me? No. I'll do what makes me happy. No one advised me to do the talk show when all my friends who are like voices of reason around me, be it Aditya Chopra or Shah Rukh Khan, or even my own mother, you know, they all said, why are you doing this? Maintain the mystery of a filmmaker. But I didn't feel the need to, you know, so I did it. When I'm told, don't dance on a reality show, don't judge it, don't make this movie, don't do this, don't do that, I do what comes to me instinctively. And whatever I've done because I believe in it so strongly. When I decided to write my memoir, I was told, you're too young, and yes, I am too young. It's not an autobiography, it's more a memoir. But I felt that I should share my journey, and that would help people, even if it resonated with a group of people, that would be a job done at my end. So as I said, that I don't know, I could be a living dichotomy, which comes with my star sign as well, because I'm Gemini and you get two for the price of one. But also because I really love what I do. I love the attention, I love the glory that surrounds me. I'm unapologetically and unabashedly in love with the movies I make and the movies that surround me. I'm just like, I'm like, I want to be pop culture. Always. I want to be relevant. It's not that I don't fear growing old, because it's a part and process of life, but I never want to stop being like relevant. What I do, I want, like, I made Student of the Year because I felt I had made two heavy films, My Name is Khan and Kabhi Alvida, and I felt I wasn't talking to a kid generation that should know who I am. Similarly, when I decided to make Aidil Mushkil, it was a piece of me, and I know there were bumps in the screenplay. I do understand why people object to the last act. I get all of that, but I believe in that story. To me, I don't know better than what I know. And I, so, like, when you ask me this question, I still don't know if I've answered it, because what I am living is an honest life. I live what I, and I love what I do, and I do it. So, and I enjoy being here, and enjoy being on Jhalak Dikhla Ja. I enjoy hosting an award show or hosting a talk show, and I enjoy doing a humongous party song in a film. It makes me joyful and gives me happiness. And I feel that eventually you've got to do what you believe in. Every time I pretended to be somebody else, it's always fallen. I've always fallen flat on my face. Sometimes I've done that as well. When I was talking about before you came, I talked about Bombay Talkies, and I was like, that was my attempt at being them. Because I felt like, you know, Anurag, Dibakar, and Zoya shouldn't feel that I'm not capable of making a film that will kind of blend in efficiently with their omnibus endeavor. And I did it. And I tried to take some slow shots and show some.
You know the story of that film, right? Karan gave the beggar three changes.
Yeah.
And his AD had to tell him, it's a beggar. Yeah. Please.
So we were doing a costume, there was a little beggar child who was the narrative of the film, and I wrote three changes because there were three scenes, until my first AD said, Karan, she's a beggar, she can't change her clothes. So I was like, okay. So there's some things that took me a while, and I don't say that with an elitist tone at all. Please, I'm completely all heart when it comes to many aspects of me, my life, and my country. But there are some things that I'm stupid about, and that was one of them.
No, but your book, Karan, is very honest, and everybody, you should see it, you know, buy it and read it, because it's a really honest account of a life, and it has so much sort of heart in it, and there are many things in it that stayed with me, among them your conversation with your mom when you came home from boarding school, 8th grade?
Yeah.
So Karan was sent off to boarding school because his mother thought that would be the right thing, and there's a really heartbreaking passage about him being awfully lonely and wanting to run away, but he was so overweight that he literally couldn't run. And, you know, and it's just heartbreaking. And he got caught, and then he convinced his dad to bring him home, but his mom was so upset that she didn't speak to him, like, the entire day. And when she did, she said to him, do you want to be mediocre all your life? You're a mediocre student. You have no interest in sports. You don't make friends. Do I want to raise a child who never made any difference to the world? There is nothing mediocre about you. Did your mom ever apologize?
No, she... Moms, don't apologize. Anu, you're one.
Yeah, there's my daughter, one.
Oh, does she apologize? Hey, congratulations. It's amazing. You have a book out. That's fantastic. Please clap for her. I didn't know she was going to ask. No, so my mom didn't apologize. You know, I think she had reached her end in terms of like trying to give me that motivation, because I was always hiding behind her or just like not inclined to doing anything like playing with the kids in the building compound, or even, you know, over and above not achieving in school, just shying away from doing everything because I was so full of indulgence. And I think she had just given up at that point. And I think it was her breaking point, is that conversation which I'll never forget, staring into the Queen's necklace from my apartment at that time. And she said, you know, I didn't raise you to be this child that, you know, that doesn't excel in something. I'm sure you're good at something. You have to be good at something. It could be anything. You know, just go and push yourself. I want you to be proud of me. And I realized that was something that I was good at. It was facing an audience. And I just, actually, it was very strangely a contradiction, because while I was very shy and introverted, but if you put me in front of an audience, I was completely comfortable. And that's the time I did. I joined the Interact Club and you know, and I joined this. And I won the first time for the school. I won the inter-school elocution competition. And it was a big moment, because that's when my mother really broke down. Because I think it was the guilt of what she had said to me and the happiness of the achievement. Because when I don't think I can ever erase that memory. It was 8 p.m. at night, and they announced my name that I had won this inter-school with Cathedral and Campion and St. Mary's and all the top schools of Bombay at that time. And they said the first prize goes to Karan Johar from Green Lawns. And I was sitting, and there was a boy called Rohan Arthur next to me, and I couldn't get up because I couldn't believe no one had ever announced my name at all, ever. In school or anywhere, like my name was not announced. It was like nobody knew I existed. And then he kept saying, Karan, they've announced your name, you won the first prize. I couldn't physically get out of my chair because I was so transfixed and shocked. And my hands were trembling, and I went up to stage, and Pearl Padamsi had given me this award. And my hands were shaking, I took it. And then I don't think I can forget that moment where the door opened, my father opened the door, and I was standing with this big cup. And my mother was in the room, and he went and knocked on the door, and he says, beta aaya hai, wo pehla prize jeet ke aaya. It was literally. So she was like, huh? And she didn't know what I was talking about. And I saw that, and I was weeping because I didn't know how else to react. And it was a big moment in my life, because I felt that that particular day changed everything for me. I think it just taught me that if you do what you love and put it out there, you can achieve so much.
And clearly you... Clearly, you also got addicted to the attention, because in your book you say, I'm an attention seeker and very proud of it. And, yeah. And you're everywhere. You're a sort of omnipresent celebrity. And you said it's all by design. And you know how you tell. I mean, I love that you're so honest about wanting your face everywhere. And you're like, you tell your publicist to do this, you tell your publicist to do that. But you also say that I project a lot. And there's a certain fatigue that creeps in. You say you're expected to be happy, you're expected to be sociable, you're expected to be there for people. These expectations drain you. So is it tiring to be Karan Johar?
No. It's. I mean, a whole lot of like all this is like, you know, just things that we lumber on ourselves. And we like go on and on about like, oh, it's tough and this is an occupational hazard. I mean, dude, we do the best job in the world. We make movies. Where else can you sing, dance, laugh and cry and still be at work? I mean, we bloody well be blessed and, you know, bloody well be really happy about what we're doing. And don't complain. So if 300 people want selfies with you, or you have a crowd that really likes and enjoys you, it's a very tiny, tiny price to pay. I don't get it. And like, you know, when I grew up in the 80s, there were Hindi film heroines who said, we can't have chaat anymore on the yeah.
Chopati pe bhel.
Chopati pe bhel, they can't have a chaat. I'm like, when were you anyway going and having bhel and chopati? I mean, it's so stupid. I mean, I hate that, you know, people get all like annoying about like the attention they get. It's so ridiculous. You do this because you want that attention. Why do you think you want to be in the movies? Because you want the fame, you want the money, you want those perks. And when they come your way, you want to shun it. I don't get it. I love it. I absolutely love it. I think that I enjoy more than, I mean, it's the fear of not being acknowledged and recognized, and when the flowers will stop coming. You know, that is the biggest fear and the burden that most of us from this zone carry. Because tomorrow, we will give failures. We will lose the battle of relevance. And you will go into fade into some kind of oblivion. And I dread those days where I'll be given a lifetime achievement award and somebody will have to hold my hand and take me up on stage. And I'll be like giving a long, boring speech and everybody will be like, yeah, bring the superstar with the item song now. Like, you know, let this old fuddy-duddy go back home and take his award with him. I know there will come a day, Anu, because life is a cycle, you know, and it's going to happen. But till that time, you've got to enjoy that's what surrounds you, and I love it. Like, and I feel like at a lot of junctures in my life, there are times where I know I've even stretched myself to do things only because I feel like I feel so blessed to be where I am, and I feel like I have to leverage that on a daily basis.
Yeah. It goes by so quickly.
Yeah, it does. And you know, it comes, it goes, and some, yes, of course, there are very strange and sad days. There are days when your films don't work. There are days that you feel unacknowledged. The day you feel somebody did better than you. There are days where your loss is made global, which is what happens with people who make movies, is that your success and failure is discussed on a national and international level on that Friday morning. Everyone who's anyone has an opinion about the work you do. It doesn't happen in most other industries, it happens in ours. And your failure is made like literally global. Everybody knows your film has flopped. So when you're out there, you feel like there are 200 faces who say, oh, poor fellow, you know, iski picture nahi chali. And like, you know, and like it's like you feel like judged on every point of time. There are those days, and you have to take that in your stride because there are also some great moments that completely dilute that, you know, and that's the way it is.
But Karan, with you, even in the movies that didn't work, and there aren't many of them, or even in, you know, when people say that, oh, his films aren't serious enough, etc., etc., nobody can take away what you create with your music. And I've told you this often enough, you know, your music has added so much joy to my life. You will all agree with me that, you know, Ae Dil Hai Mushkil, that soundtrack was easily the best soundtrack of last year. You know? Where does this impeccable taste in music come from?
From only knowing Hindi film music and nothing else. Ever since I was a child, that's what I heard. My mother used to listen to all the Mohammad Rafi, Kishore Kumar, Lata Ji, Asha Ji songs. My father, just like me, was tone deaf. None of us could sing. So we used to just hear, and because I heard all the songs, when the VHS phase came out, which was the video phase, for kids in this room
won't even know. Yeah, they're like, what?
Like, whatever. There was something called a video cassette that came out in the late 70s, early 80s. And I used to watch all the movies where kids my age were like watching like cartoons and stuff like that. I was watching Gurudatt and Bimal Roy and vintage Raj Kapoor and hearing that music every day. For me, I'm completely dramatic like that. When there's a sad situation in my life, I'll hear Lag Ja Gale. When there's happiness, I'll hear. Like, I'm all about Hindi film music. I'm obsessed by it. Like, that's all I ever listen to. My iPod, my iPad, my eye, everything has just Hindi film songs. Like, there's nothing. I don't know what anybody else does. Like, what I know, I hear these names because I'm meant to know what Beyonce's new album is or what Adele has sung, but I mean, I really don't care. And, the only time that I understand that track is when I understand the sound, because I know that I have to update my sound, because that I know. So I listen.
So you're listening to it.
Yes, so I'm listening. So the best thing I have to tell you, and I'll sound frivolous again, which I don't mind, to tell you that when you shop, you listen to a lot of music because all the stores are playing the current hits. So you get the sound in your head, and I'm observant like that. So that track, that music, the melody, just the beat, the groove gets ingrained into my inner zone. So when I have an Ae Dil Hai Mushkil, I know that the title song needs an old school melody with a contemporary arrangement. I know the importance of the two, which is why, you know, but then there's something, suddenly a song like Channa Meria, which is the most vintage Hindi film song, but it's deeply rooted in intensity, will connect because some things just don't fail. But you know, you have to balance it to get that, you have to get that chul right, and you have to get the Channa Meria right, you know. So they're two different, completely polarized, like, kind of songs, but you've got to be you have to understand what the requirement of the generation is. And I realized that, like Bhushan Kumar once told me, he said it, which Farah then very intelligently adapted. He said, do kisam ke gaane chalte hain, dard ke gaane aur disco ke gaane. So that's why she had that song, Darde Disco. Because she said, I'll give them both to you in one song. But actually, he said, yeah, angst It's amazing how I feel the generation in this room responds so deeply to angst, to heartbreak, to unfulfilled love. Whereas the quintessential happy zone of love is something that everyone finds boring. When there is an angst in your love story, that means you haven't really loved at all. And I think that's beautiful because there's nothing more fulfilling than an unfulfilled relationship, I think.
Artistically.
Yeah. And I think that, you know, there is something, all the drama, the angst. I mean, if everybody just loved each other, then where's the fun, yeah? I mean, you know, it's the way it is.
Karan, what makes a great director?
A great observer makes a great director. I think if you can just stare at body language, human behavior patterns, responses to emotions, and scenes come out of observations. To me, it's the way I believe that a good director is. I feel like you can't disassociate a man or a woman's observations from his filmmaking or her filmmaking. I think what his thoughts are, his observations are, her reflections are, her theories are, her ideologies are, will all penetrate through his or her work. And I think that my observations are the result of my filmmaking, and that's what I think makes a great filmmaker. I think if you have blinkers on, you can't be a good filmmaker. You've got to keep your vistas open to what's happening around you.
But do you ever feel that you need to step out of your comfort zone in terms of the things you know and the people you know?
Yeah.
To be better as a director?
Yes, I think so. And I have tried that sometimes, but I rarely do it because I'm scared. Because I feel like when I'm out of my comfort zone, like I really struggle directing My Name is Khan. Because for me, it was the first time that I had to know about a mental condition I wasn't aware of, a political climate that I should not venture into without completely understanding every side of the story. And I did fumble and fall in 15 minutes of that film in the Wilhelmina block because I knew nothing about the African-American ethos. And I completely failed that zone of that film because I didn't know enough. But I still went out there and did it. So that was the one film that I remember that I felt scared. Even today, I want to go out of my comfort zone, but I'm afraid. I'm deeply afraid. I don't know if I can justify it. And I feel if I'm going to not be able to live up to the expectations of the narrative, then I shouldn't tell the story. But having said that, nothing ventured, nothing gained. So there's always this inner kind of debate that I have with myself, is human being versus filmmaker? And I don't know which one will eventually emerge.
But when you do an Aadil and Mushkil, you feel completely in control. And with a My Name is Khan, you felt out of your depth.
Completely, completely. Aadil and Mushkil was so, it came so organically and naturally to me that that's why some people didn't get what I was trying to say, because it was completely my thought. It was why. So people who resonated with what I thought should be, like everyone said that, why did you have to kill her? Why the cancer block? I'm like, if she doesn't love, she has to die. I believe. And
off with her head.
I'm like, kill her. See, you're God when you're a filmmaker. You can make anything happen. I'm like, kill her. Like, she has to die. Without any hair. So it's okay. I mean, I say that in jest, but I mean, that was the way I chose to write. That film, I just understood because I felt the beats of that pain. I felt that unrequited love. I felt that moment where you really feel like that pain in your heart is like a physical pain. It's like an tooth extraction. You feel like it really hurts, you know, and I felt that pain. It's two junctures of my life. And I just felt that Ranbir was playing a large part of what I've lived. And when I was telling the story, at one point I remember he looked at me and he said, "Ye tere saath hua hai kya?" Because I was seeing it with such, you know, I was really feeling that scene. I said, "Yes, it's true. It's happened to me. I have not sung Channa Meri at a wedding, but I really wanted to.
You've been there.
I've been there when a wedding happening in front of me, and I was so deeply in love, and I was like, I wanted somebody to just kill me and murder me. It felt like a huge pain in your heart. So when I was directing that scene, I was a complete mess, and yet I was so assured about what I wanted. There are just bits and pieces of that film that I feel are completely real to me and my life. And I feel a bits of those scenes and are a big part of me, whether people got it or not, was upsetting and both, I think, elevating. The people who got it, I was like, fantastic, you got it. Those who didn't, I get why they perhaps didn't, because it suddenly takes a strange turn, the film, you know, and that's the way I always saw that story. But I just so enjoyed the process. I so enjoyed making that film, every bit of it, every single bit of it.
What makes a good producer?
a detachment from the director, staying away completely. Once you've greenlit the film, just stay away. Just stay away and let him or her make their film. Because that's what I do. Because you cannot, I've seen producers who are completely proactive. But then why are you a producer? A producer is somebody in our system. You greenlight a film, you make sure the funds are in place, you make sure you leverage the best cast and crew for that film, and then you stay out. Because that's not your voice. It should not be. It's not your language. It should not be. It's their language, their voice, their filmmaking. When they get it right, applaud. When they don't, move on. It's as simple. We've made movies that have done immensely well as producers. We've made films that have flopped terribly. There are screenplays I loved when I greenlit. But when I saw the film, I was like, oh my God, someone kill me. No one's going to like this film and it's going to do really badly. And I never lied to the director. In the confines of the edit room, when we see the final cut, I give my honest opinion. And I say, look, this film is not going to work, but let's go out there and promote like it's the best film ever. But it's really awful. And what do you do? And you know, it's happened to me not once. I've had this conversation thrice in my life, where I've said there's nothing we can do to save it. When there are things you can do to save it, you do it. There are reshoots, there are re-edits, there are adjustments. But eventually, it's their film. I've never in my career as a producer, Anu, ever gone on set besides day one of any of the films I produced. I've never been on set. Never. Not
you
once.
You told me you also don't get involved with the promotions. You just kind of...
No, I don't promote films I produce because it's the director. It's their glory. It's his or her glory. It's their cast. But even if it's a great film, I don't want to stand there and behave like suddenly take onus. Why? It's their film. Good, bad, ugly, they should own it. They should get the props for it. They should... And I'm willing to take some of the brickbats that come my way because it's coming from my home and house and my production house. So I get it, but I stay away. The only way you can be a good producer is if you're a detached producer.
You know, there was a roundtable done by The Hollywood Reporter where it was actresses, and they asked Amy Adams about wage parity. And she said that, look, I'm not going to answer this question. She said, ask producers. They're the people who are signing the paycheck. And when are actors going to be paid the same as actresses and vice versa? So speaking of you as producer, when do you think we will see, and I understand it's bums on seats, and you know, when there is a woman who can bring in the amount of people that Amir or Shah Rukh or Salman do, you will have wage parity. But I've been told, and not once, but by many actresses, that even when it's a situation where it's a new boy and a new girl, the new boy will always get more money than the new girl. Is that true?
No, not in my case. When I launched Varun, Sid and Alia, they all got the same number.
Really?
They all got the same number. Each one of them got the same number. I would never do that even with a female director and a male first-time director. They get the same number. Why should there be any kind of disparity in remuneration? But yes, when it comes to the big movie stars, you guys make the men the bigger movie stars. We can't do anything.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, when an audience empowers the women more, kudos to them. I would love to pay Deepika Padukone more than I would pay Ranbir Kapoor. You know, I would love to. But the truth of the matter is that she opens to a number solo and he opens to a number solo, and it's as simple as that. And that's the mathematic you go as a producer. But when it comes to first-time actors, why the hell should you pay the poor girl does more work sometimes, you know? She's always there, all there. I know what it takes into kind of in the zone of glamour for what women have to go through, you know, eventually. And I think it's, and I don't endorse that school of thought. But yes, in the larger scheme of things, like, it. See, in Hollywood, it's completely different though, because it's not the way it's dictated by at our end. Today there are certain women that, you know, Jennifer Lawrence probably has much more, you know, going for her than some of the younger new talent that is walking in, you know, maybe even including a Casey Affleck. Like, if there's a solo Casey Affleck film and a solo Jennifer Lawrence, she bloody well get more money because she's 10 times the movie star. But it doesn't work like that in India. You know, today, I mean, you know, it's like we have six movie stars who are huge and they're men, and they pull a large part of the muscle that the film fraternity is all about. And then there are a few women who are doing really well, but they can't still match the numbers there because they don't get that opening and that, you know, they don't get those, the economics on satellite, music, overseas, digital, theatrical. On none of them, they're pulling in the same number. So therefore, there is this disparity.
But you know, I was doing an interview with Sonam Kapoor, and she said to me that she and Kareena are making a movie together called Veere Di Shaadi.
Right,
and,
right.
And you know, Sonam, of course, has just had Nirja, and Kareena's been in a couple of hit movies as well, Ki and Ka and Urta Punjab. And she said they could not get the money that John and Varun Dhawan got for Dishu, even though all else being equal. I mean, is there just... a sort of understood pact that women will get less money.
Varun Dhawan is a bigger movie star.
Than Sonam Kapoor?
Yes.
Really?
Yes. See his logistics.
Yeah, he hasn't had, he's only delivered.
See his logistics.
Yeah.
He has an ABCD that opens to 14 crores. Nija opened to 4.
Right.
And then it grew to be a wonderful, fantastic film. Varun Dhawan's Dishoom, I'm just saying, with John, opens to 11 crores. So,
and this, it's unlikely that a Sonam Kareena
movie... Badlapur opens to 8 crores. It's an alternate film.
Right.
Now, Badrinath will release. We'll see the number. Mm. He is a huge star. He's going to pull the muscle. And Sonam is an amazing beauty, a humongously talented girl whose Neeja was one of my favorite films last year. Fantastic. And she's going to do phenomenally and do more great work. But she cannot compare the economics between her and Varun Dhawan. It just is not, it's for you to see. I just gave you a whole list.
A couple of weeks ago, was it last week that Kangana was on your show? Was
right.
It was last week, right? And she said, you're the flag bearer of nepotism. She called you the movie mafia. Did you, Karan, sort of, you looked a little taken aback by that.
You know,
did you see that coming at all?
Anu, I have to say, and this is probably the first time I will be speaking about it, is like when you invite a guest, you're going to be kind.
Of course.
So she was my guest.
Yeah.
So I have to hear what she has to say, and she has a right to have an opinion. When she says flag bearer of nepotism, I just want to say, I'm glad she knows what it all means. I don't think she's understood the entirety of that statement. Because what is nepotism? That am I working with my nephews, nieces, daughters, sons, and what about those 15 filmmakers who are not from the film industry who have launched and put into movies? That no one will talk about. That no one will talk about a Tarun Mansukhani who didn't come from the movies. You know, or a Puneet Malhotra who's a costume designer's nephew. He's not entirely, that doesn't qualify as nepotism. Shakun Batra, who came from no film background. Shashank Khetan, who comes from no film background. You give these people film careers and they have and platforms to stand on, that is the reverse of nepotism. But that, of course, you will not get credit.
Maybe
because
she was talking about the actors.
But that's two of them, Alia Bhatt and Varun Dhawan, that you've introduced. And Siddharth Malhotra is also part, one third of that pie, who's got nothing to do with the movies. So I didn't get what she meant. I mean, she meant movie mafia. What does she mean? Because what does she think we're doing? Sitting and not giving her work? Is that what makes us mafia? No, we do that because by choice. You know, not because we do that because I do that because maybe I'm not interested in working with her. That doesn't make me movie mafia. It makes me a man with an opinion. You know, so I mean, I don't get that on certain levels. And I appreciate that she had a great, great, great perspective and point of view. And everyone lauded her because she came on my show and gave it off to Karan, according to what, you know, everyone said. I'm like, of course, because I was gracious enough to keep everything. I cut none of it out. I kept it. I could have edited so much out. It was my show. I said, no, let the world see that this is her opinion and she must say it, voice it. I gave her the platform. This is my platform, so I'm telling you what I think. I want to say, I'm done with Kangana playing the woman card and the victim card. I'm done. I mean, you cannot be this victim at every given point of time who has a sad story to tell about how you've been terrorized by the bad world of the industry. Leave it. Who's forcing you on a gunpoint to be here in the movies? Leave. Do something else.
No, I think maybe, and I'm trying to interpret what she meant here, but maybe.
But all of you only chane ke jhaad pe upar ab daloge, so then this is what will happen.
It's all my fault. No, I think, but Karan, you'll agree.
Listen, I have to say this on record. Kangana Ranaut is an outstanding artist.
She is
outstanding. Her performance in Queen and Tanu Weds Manu is phenomenal. Returns and the first part. Yeah. There is no better performance. She deserves both her performance and fashion. She deserves all the national awards.
Yeah.
But am I to agree with her statements that she has made? No, that's not.
No,
what
but,
I am here.
But Karan, is there... And there has been, I mean, the industry has been extremely nepotistic. It has changed over the last 10, 15 years. Do you see the world getting less insular, sort of more open when it comes to actors? Yes. You know, directors, it's really opened up.
Yes,
but
totally.
What about actors?
Well, it is going to take, of course, and there are some, Ranveer Singh is like, the biggest movie stars in this country are not from the industry.
Yeah.
Shah Rukh Khan is not from here. Amitabh Bachchan is not from here.
Yeah.
You know, Dilip Kumar was not from the industry. So there were some great talents and they will keep happening. It sometimes is tough because it's a comfort zone that you fall into when it comes to nepotism. And, you know, it's eventually also a commercial thing. A big movie star's son is going to get the eyeballs initially, so you take that, you don't want to take a chance because it's money and you know we're not getting the kind of footfalls. Sometimes nepotism is out of like a reason that happens, that you know you feel protected by that, you know, that zone. And also it's, some of it is also just the order, like sometimes a director's in front of you because you know you've seen the talent because somebody called you and you know them personally and said my uncle or my nephew or my son wants to come. You give them that job because you think that you're doing your own fraternity a favor, and then you see talent and then you give that talent a platform. Sometimes it happens as organically as that. It's not a strategy that we will only work from within. Not at all. My doors in Dharma Productions are open to talent from anywhere. It's sometimes access is an issue. You know, it's not as structured. We don't have film schools like the West does. We don't have academic institutions where you have graduates that come out from film schools that walk into offices with their CVs. We don't have those. Where are those academic institutions? We have three of them. So when people come in, we only come in through relations or relatives or people you know around you, that's around you. It's sometimes the default of the system that results in nepotism.
There is no other
way. Yes.
But now you're launching... The two daughters, Sridevi and Boni's.
No, I'm not launching anyone as of now. I'm not launching.
Yeah, no.
I'm not launching anyone. I'm trying very hard to launch myself. I'm not launching anybody till it's out there. Like there's a lot of talk and
yes, there is a lot of talk.
Yeah, but there is a lot of conjecture. But but no, there it isn't. Nothing is for a fact right now. Nothing, and clearly nothing. Really, truly, nothing is fructified into a project as yet.
Carrie Fisher wrote in Postcards from the Edge that you'll never get any genuine closeness in Hollywood because everybody does fake closeness too well.
Yeah.
Is that true of Bollywood as well?
Oh, yeah. But you do fake closeness everywhere. We're just more talked about. Everywhere in the world, when people meet each other at parties and social events, does everyone really feel that love? Sometimes it's just a norm, it's just politeness. It's just like, fake closeness is like you do sometimes, you know, for your convenience. Sometimes you've got to be nice to someone because you need them to be, you know, professional in your zone of work. And you stretch yourself at that time. You try and make fake look as real because that's an art form. And some of us have mastered it and some of us haven't. But there is, when you use the word fake, it sounds so trivial and frivolous. But it's true to just being polite sometimes. You could perceive it as being fakeness. But actually you're just being polite. Like I was polite to Kangana Ranaut. I was not fake. You know?
Yes.
Yeah, so like it was politeness. It's like, are you been raised well? You know, you just the way it is. So when you meet someone and air kiss them and say, really nice to meet you, of course you're not really happy to meet that person sometimes. You know? You're just saying really nice to meet you because it's polite, you were raised well. Or when you say you look lovely, you know, sometimes you don't look lovely. But you know, I can tell from your face that you want a compliment, so I'll say it. You know, sometimes, and I know I want it sometimes. It's the same thing. So sometimes you're just nice because it's expected of you.
If you could change one thing about the industry, what would it be?
Punctuality. I have a big problem. That was not a reflection on you coming late today, Anu, because I have to say Anu is the most professional, punctual person I know. She's always ready, always on time. In fact, she's the one person, if you send a message to, you'll get a reply within 3 minutes. So, I mean, that was not a reflection, though it came out really well at the right time, I have to say. But I have a disorder. It's like something I got from my father. I remember I have a childhood memory of circling places because we were early, you know, so that we didn't want to, like, because sometimes being too early is also impolite. I have just that big problem with people. When they say 5, it does not mean 5:15 in my dictionary. It means 5. And when they say we want 1 hour with you, it doesn't mean 2 hours. It means 1 hour. So I take timings very seriously, but no one else does.
But you've made so many films with Shah Rukh. I mean, he's...
No, but I have a great...
Never been punctual in
No,
his
but
life.
I have an art form about that. I know exactly. I cracked the code.
Which is?
I befriended the wife. You must understand that now I'm on call with her. She calls me, she says, now come. Right. And I'm not leaving my office till I know he's home. Yeah. Then, because I know once he's there, see, also their family to me, so I can play with the kids, and not anymore, of course, they're all grown up. Yeah. But I used to come there and sit and like do my thing, and then it was fine. Waiting for Shah Rukh was like never a problem because it was like my home. But then when I was working, I would say, Gauri, just tell me when he's home and ready for this meeting, I'll leave. So I cracked that code with him. I never had a problem.
As a director, Karan, what do you want for yourself? What do you kind of, what's the leap you want to make in the next 5 years?
I want 5 stars from you, Anu. I want you to call me after you've seen my film and you can't, because Anu has this ethic, which I really appreciate. She doesn't tell anyone when she sees a film what she thought of it till the release Friday. So I want you to kind of break that rule, see my film and call me and say, I stood up and clapped at the end of the film. No, but I mean that. I do mean that. You don't understand. You don't know what it would mean to me if you really loved a film of mine a lot. Like, it would mean a lot to me, and that kudos to you for achieving that. Because I really want to make a film that is like a Lagan. I haven't made one. Like, or a Dangal, or a Rang De Basanti. Cult, appreciated commercially, loved critically, and applauded internationally. I really want to make that film. I haven't. I've made a lot of fun, happy, feel-good, pop culture successes. I haven't made a great film as yet. I really want to make a great film.
Karan, you talk often about wanting to win an Oscar. You know, you have this whole dream in your head about the speech that you're going to give and you're going to say, this one's for you, India. And, you know, despite what happened at the Oscars this year, it is the award that all of us
want.
It's
a big platform, yeah.
It's a big platform. So, and you know, you've talked to me often enough about how our awards are just, you know, what is the validation that they give you? Nothing, right? But you're still there. You're at every award function. How do you reconcile the knowledge that the truth is these mean very little with your presence and your involvement in all these awards?
I get paid, Anu.
That's it.
I get paid. It's simple. It's a job. It's commerce meets art. It's my commerce of the moment meets the art of the people who are making it. I haven't won a single award since My Name is Khan. It's been 6-7 years I haven't won an award. I've been hosting all the shows. And I do it when I get paid. When I'm not winning an award and I'm not getting paid, I don't go.
At all?
Yeah.
But Karan, until... So this is one of my sort of real, pet kind of griefs in life is that, you know, how will anyone take us seriously as long as we're doing these sort of...
No, but if there was an academy that did it in a legit way and did an award show, and I think Film Fest still, I believe, very strongly gets the formatting as right as they can. There's a structured format. Till we have an academy of 1,000 people where all the biases get offset and you have a strong award where everyone attends and comes, and it's not a television show that is dependent on TRPs and, you know, the ratings and sponsorships, then of course I will take it seriously. You know, when there is that award, like the National Award, I take very seriously. I've never won it, but I've taken it very seriously. I won it once for Kuch Kuch Hota and that was it. Never won one after. But if I won a National Award, it would mean a lot to me. I wouldn't be wanting to perform at a National Award or be paid to be there. I would be there for the respect, the platform, the legitimacy, the transparency of it, perhaps. But if there are, the award shows are entertaining shows. They're entertaining. And yes, the people who win it take the year, like Javed Saab once told me, take awards seriously the year you get them. And if you get them, like enjoy it. Like enjoy the euphoria and move on to your next. If you don't get it, don't lament, because I'm not sure how worth it is. How will we be taken seriously now? There's a lot that has to change, and I'm not going to be the flag bearer of that movement. I mean, when it happens, it'll happen. But I mean,
you're not wanting to lead this.
No, I don't want to kind of lead anything, barring like wherever I'm required, I'm there. Industry issues, crisis, I'm there. Producer guild meetings, I'm there. You call me for mommy, I'm there. I try to be as there as I can be for everyone in the movie industry, because I believe we're a fraternity. I still very strongly feel we're a strong community of people who come together when it's required. But now this is just, the system has just gone out of whack when it comes to award shows, and there's nothing, because every channel wants to have an award. They want to have a property. It's not about who wins, it's about who performs and how well it rates. So unfortunately, who's going to break the shackles of that? Anyone who tries to do a decent job, then, you know, it goes into other problems and other issues. And I believe Filmfare gets it as right as it can.
I suppose it'll only stop when the stars say no. That's the only way.
Well, they're not saying no. Not for a while.
Do you have to go? Can I ask 2 more questions?
Yes, yes.
I have a flight to catch.
Oh no, what time?
The 9 p.m. flight, and this traffic on Trafalgar Square is a bit alarming.
Okay, last one. Yeah. Tell me, in your book you said happiness is the most overrated emotion. What did you mean?
I don't understand when people say... So there's a song, and I think I quoted it in the book, I'm not sure, though I can't remember it, which, if you take in the spirit of positivity, for everyone here, who's, everyone speaks Hindi? Okay. So it's Rahi Manwa, Dukh Ki Chinta, Kyu Satati Hai, Dukh To Apna Saathi Hai. Sukh Hai Ek Chhau Dhalti, Aati Hai Jati Hai, Dukh To Apna Saathi Hai. So it's actually a very positive take on what we consider sadness. You know, it's like things that are slow, are difficult, unhappy is what we perceive it to be, but we envelop it and embrace it. It could actually make life much easier. Happiness, like they say, sukh hai ek chhau dhalti aati hai jati hai, because if you realize that in a day when you get some enormously amazing news that makes your heart happy and your serotonin levels higher and you get really excited, you know in 5 minutes someone will grab you off it. There will be some stress, some diversion, some other news, something that will change your mood immediately. It doesn't last very long, what we perceive that happiness to be. So I realized to embrace what we consider sadness and give it a dose of happiness internally, and you'll be a much more satisfied human being. When I say happiness is overrated, it's like what we consider celebratory happiness, that's overrated.
Euphoria.
Yeah, that it's overrated because it won't last. So might as well go through the beats of life, and I say this with absolutely no cynicism and no amount of negativity. I say this with practicality, that this is the order of our lives. We have difficulties, we have turbulences, we have problems, we have a crisis. We've got to embrace it and make it our own and consider that to be our happy space. That's what will make us happy eventually.
And is there a mantra that you live by?
I mean, not a line or anything intelligent or quotable that I can think of immediately. But I just think that just not being judgmental can be so liberating. To not care so much about like everything else around you, that you have to constantly judge somebody else, their actions, their moves, or some things that happen, constantly have an opinion and judgmental, and just I think it dilutes and takes away so much from your own thoughts. I think constantly worrying about what surrounds you and giving your opinion on a daily basis or a moment-to-moment basis can be so exhausting. So I just feel like let it be. Just, you know, that's what Zen is all about. People either seek that through chanting or through meditation, through prayer, through religion. I think that's something that you can teach yourself, to just detach. Being like Shah Rukh used a very interesting term on my show called emotional, to be detached but emotional. And I think that is, if you can achieve that, then, you know, life would be a better place.
Be emotional. Thank you so much. I'm guessing you don't have time for, you've done the Q&A
before you came. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Karan.
No, thanks,
and more power to you. I know you'll make a great film.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh.